Good afternoon. Welcome to Bible Fellowship Church. Thank you for joining us on this Saturday afternoon. Appreciate your support for the Spurlock family. Carol Big Mama has been a huge blessing to our church family, and so we're, in one sense, we're sad, in another sense, we're excited about where she is and what her life has meant to us over the years. And so I'm going to read a couple passages of scripture for you, but as we get started, I've got a welcome home little poem I want to read. This was read at Lindsay's aunt's service, and so John asked me if I would read this as we get started. Where I'm going, release me and let me go. I have so many things to see and do. You mustn't tie yourself to me with tears. Be happy that we had so many years. I gave you my love. You can give it to others also. How much you gave to me in happiness, but now it's time I've traveled alone. So grieve a while for me, if grieve you must. Then let your grief be comforted by trust. It's only for a while that we must part. So bless the memories within your heart. I won't be far away. Life goes on. So if you need me, call, and I will come. Though you can't see me or touch me, I'll be near. And if you listen with your heart, you will hear all my love around you, soft and clear. And then, when we must come this way alone, I will greet you with a smile and welcome you home. Passage of scripture out of Carol's Bible, Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8, 9, and 10. For by grace you've been saved through faith, and not of yourselves, it's a gift of God. Not of works, lest anyone should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath ordained that we should walk in them. 2 Timothy chapter 4. I charge you therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead as appearing in his kingdom. Preach the word, be instant in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For a time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but they'll go after their own lust and shall heap them and listen to their teachers, having itching ears. And they shall turn away from their ears from truth, and that shall be turned unto fables. But watch in all things, endure afflictions, but do the work of an evangelist. Make full proof of your ministry. For I am now ready to be offered, and the time for my departure is at hand. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Father, we gather today to celebrate a life that rings true. She did keep the faith. She did love you. She did finish well. And so, Father, we are thankful this afternoon that we get to celebrate Big Mama's life. What a privilege that is. But really, we're celebrating you, Jesus, inside of her. And you transformed her. And we got a chance to watch that, feel that, see that. And we are testimony today that she wasn't just an individual that knew about you, Jesus, but she followed you. And our lives will never be the same because of that. And so, Father, may that be true of us as we pause to remember an individual that you changed. May one day individuals stand up and say the same thing about us, about what you did and how they saw you in us for your glory, Jesus. That's what Carol wants, and that's what we want to. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Would you join us in How Great Thou Art?
Let's stand together and sing this wonderful hymn. The words are on the screen for you. You should know them.
Oh, Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displays. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, how great thou art.
may be seated.
Hey, Mom. How are you? I'm doing okay. Just wanted to talk to you for a minute. I know you're with God, Daddy and Jeff, and everybody else. Saturday was rough, I'll tell you that. You had one of the best days you'd ever had in a long time. And I'll tell y'all, that was hint number one. You spoke to a lot of people that morning before I ever got there. We had a great few hours. As your body started to fight harder Saturday afternoon, you fought back, just like you always have. Caroline, one of the best nurses that I've seen all week, was in the room while you were fighting, and she started to pray. Brought a smile and a tear to my face. Hint number two. I got you laid back in the bed, and I told you you needed to relax. Find something that would make you relax. You started to sing. Every day with Jesus. Hint number three. I started to cry because I knew you were ready. 7:30 was time for me to go. I knew I had 3 hours to get back to Venus. What a fight between myself. But that sense of peace came over. It said she's going to be okay. I knew. I knew before I ever left. So I looked at you and I said, are you sure? Because you told me to leave. I said, are you sure? I asked your permission one last time. You know, because we didn't do anything without asking Mom's permission. So you told me to go home and rest. You're going to need your rest. Go home. You told me thank you for everything. You said, I love you. But one thing you didn't tell me was that you wouldn't see me tomorrow. So I knew that was the longest 3 hours back home. And Rusty called, and it hit. But being who I am, I knew where you were at. I knew God had then called you off his roll, and it was time to receive you at the gates of heaven. So yes, your baby cried. I hurt and I miss you, Mom. I love you. Thank you all for coming today to celebrate our mother, our big mama, and everybody's friend. There's so many stories that we've all heard and that we all know. At some point, please share them, because that's how we need to remember my mom. You know, Saturday night, Sunday started a new chapter for Mama in her life. The last one was filled with love for each one of us, and she shared it with us in some way or form. Her love had no boundaries with any of us. And her love to me, some days was harder than others. She shared that hard love. A lot of it was because of me, but she shared it. For those of y'all don't know, I had a few bad days growing up. And Mom kind of tried to straighten them days out early some mornings with a belt. But she... You know, I can't complain, wouldn't tell anybody any different. My mom treated me with grace and love, and taught me to be the man that I am today. At least I hope I am. There are four of you in here today that were very, very special to my mother. Those were the hardest phone calls to make Sunday morning. Ebba, Susie, Kay, and Elaine. Thank you all for your love, the time that you shared with my mother, and the love that you gave back to her. She was totally grateful, or very grateful of y'all's friendships. Mom loved the church. She definitely loved her God. She installed God's love with the family early on. Bible fellowship became her second home. Many of y'all knew her as Carol. A lot of you, y'all, she became Big Mama to y'all as well. Big Mama had her top favorite, and six of them are sitting along this front row. Bailey, you held a very special place in Big Mama's heart. You filled a void that was left with Jeff the year after you were born. You're going to always be her number one. Dylan and Sierra, she loved you both. She cherished you both. Kylie, Tanner, and Braden, y'all became her bonus grandkids. Big Mama accepted y'all early in mine and Linda's relationship. I can remember her introducing herself to y'all as Carol, but it was very shortly in that same conversation that she told y'all that her name was Big Mama. Rusty, Lindsay, Charlene, and Robert, and Linda and I have sat around the dining room table several nights this week and on the phone talking about our mom. We've laughed and we've cried. We've even asked a couple times who met her at the gate. I think we all said Daddy and Jeff did. But I think God had to call the disciples out to hold the crowd. There was one other special person that was at that gate too, and that was Linda. Linda was her baby sister, joy of her life. I could just hear them at the gate. Y'all going to try to excuse me. I'm going to try to say something here. I can hear Daddy. Daddy always called her honey. And him say, honey, welcome home. And Jeff would look at her and go, Mama, glad you're here. I wish I could say it in Linda's voice. I really do. But it would be something to this extent. It'd be, Carol, what are you doing? And y'all just had to know my Aunt Linda. But Mom is home, and I know that. So we're here to celebrate my mother's life, and thank y'all for being a part of it.
When Dad asked me if I wanted to speak, I was unsure if I could do it, but I know that she's... I know that she's watching me with the biggest smile on her face. The past couple years have been crazy, but she always reminded me that she... that is what God has planned for our family. But one thing about my Big Mama was that whenever we got together, she always asked about either my schooling or my sports. When I told her I was doing a medical assisting program certification out at the college, she was happy for me. She was always telling me how happy she was that I was doing this, no matter how hard it got through COVID and all, and that I stuck through it for the past 3 years. And she's always asking me about my classes and all of the crazy stuff that I did. With it being my senior year and things finally getting back to normal in schools, and I told her that I was going to go to my senior prom and that I wanted her there for photos beforehand, she was kind of shocked. But once she saw me in my big poofy dress, she just loved it. And that's something that I will never forget because of the look in her eyes when she saw me get out of my truck and that she was there. But that's when it came down to graduation time, and I told her that I'd be walking my college stage before my high school one, and she was so excited for me. But having her there at both of them is one of my favorite memories from this year because I knew how proud of me she was. When it came to my sports growing up, she would always try her best to be there. And when she was there, it was always made me the happiest to see her there. On the side of the softball field or even at my swim meets. And even if she was not there, she would call or text me about them, or I would call her and let her know how I did. Or even when I started showing pigs, she thought that it was, she would come down to Dad's to watch me and I would get him out and walk him for her. And she just loved that, even if they just ran around and it was me chasing them. But some of my favorite things about my big mama was that she had a love for God and how she made me love him even more. I always remember getting up and coming to church with her and getting my first Bible from her. When it comes to summertime every year, she always said, "You ready for BBS?" And I love that, because I would come with her early and help in the kitchen and then run back and forth into the kitchen because I could just go in and help her or just hang out in the kitchen area with her. But if I could just see my big mama one more time. I just want one more hug. That's all I want from her.
I'm going to begin with a scripture from Philippians chapter 4. This scripture, to me, epitomizes my friend Carol. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I will say rejoice. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything. But Carol was always anxious, always concerned for the safety of her family. But in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is anything excellent, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about those things. That was Carol Spurlock that I knew. God brought Carol and I together in the sanctuary of this church one morning when I came down from my seat back at the back to her seat next to Susie, and I said, "I need to get to know you better." And we started going out and having breakfast together. And then in January of 2016, my husband went to Bangladesh on a mission trip, and Carol had been dealing with a issue with her leg and getting over a broken leg, and she was concerned about being at home alone so at night. So I said, "Well, if my husband's gone anyhow, I'll just come over and we can hang out together." That week that we were together every night was a binding that brought a friendship into my life. I remember Carol and I would have phone calls, my phone calls with Carol were normally at least an hour long. And she would tell me stories about family. I knew the family. I knew about Harry. I knew about Bob. I knew about the time when she went and visited with Rusty and Lindsay and the joy she had being with her brothers, and also the absolute pain of being without Linda. When I stayed with her that week, she brought out her album of Linda. She had a picture album of Linda. And I learned to listen. I learned to listen to wisdom. She would tell me that she was talking to the man upstairs. And she always talked to the man upstairs. Carol was had deep feelings. And when she was hurting, it ran deep. When she lost her sister, I know when she lost Carl and Jeff, I didn't know her then, but I can only imagine. She told me that when Jeff died and when Carl died, that she would just go out in the car by herself and just scream with the pain of loss. And I think she probably did that when Linda died as well. Carol had so many facets, but the biggest facet, it was like a jewel. And the jewel that I saw in Carol was a jewel of love. She loved her family. And she, every time we talked, I heard about John and Linda. I heard about Bailey. I heard about when Braden was going off to be in the service. And having lived in Chicago, I knew where he was going. Had been on the Navy base before. The love she had for God was the greatest love she had. And I always love talking with her about scripture because somehow I would get an insight from her, she would get an insight from me, and we would both come away fuller from that conversation. She loved, loved, loved Todd. You were just, and Eugene, both of you were just shining stars in her heart. I love the fact that when she talked to God, she didn't talk in flowery language. She didn't have to make anything up. She conversed with God as if he was right with her, because we know he is. We don't worry about him losing track of us because he lives within us. And for Carol, he lived within her. I remembered one time that I got in trouble with Carol. And that was when she asked me something and I answered, "What?" And I found out very quickly that you never said "What" to Carol Spurlock. You had better say, "Yes, ma'am." I learned that, and it only took one time of being told, and I had it forever. I appreciated so much about Carol, her love for me, that I still don't understand. I don't think I've ever had a friend who loved me as much as Carol did. She would call me, "Darling. How are you today, darling?" We talked the morning that she died. I called her on my car phone as I was traveling, and we talked on the car phone. There will never be another Carol Spurlock. She was a diamond that was priceless and will forever be in our hearts. There will never be a time that I ever forget your mom, your grandma. I never called her Big Mama. I'm not sure how I got by with that, but I told her, "You know, you are Carol to me, so I'm sorry, I can't do this Big Mama thing." But I thank you so much, John, for giving me the opportunity to talk about your mom and my relationship with her that wasn't real obvious when I lived here. When I drove back to Indianapolis one time by myself in the car with the dog, it was your mom who called me along the way to make sure I was okay. I will miss her prayers. I will miss her as a prayer warrior over my life. But I am so blessed to have been someone that she loved. Because when she loved you, and she loved you, Bailey, with a passion, when you were loved by Carol Spurlock, you were loved as if you were loved by God. Thank you, and God bless you.
I'm not the speaker that Kay is. I just talk. Carol and I met 50 years ago in Sunday school class at First Baptist. And you know, when you meet somebody in a Sunday school class, you meet a real person. And I could go on and tell you stories of 50 years of friendship, but you wouldn't want to hear some of them. One thing Carol had, I always say she had a rap sheet of medical history. If it was to be had, Carol has had it. And yet she never, ever complained about anything. She did not care that she had lost so much hair when her dad died. It was not a big concern. She didn't care if she had to wear that much lift on her shoe and have to wear ugly shoes when everybody else had gorgeous shoes. Carol never complained. One thing, though, Carol was an in-charge person and a bossy person, and you all know that, so you know I'm not making that up. But she was a friend that we could laugh together, we could cry together, and we could pray together, and that's a treasure. And I thank God for her and all the singers that are here. I know she would be thrilled to see Harry and Bobby, all of you. She loved you all, and she loved her children, and she loved us.
So speaking of Carol being in charge, John brought in a notebook on Thursday afternoon, and so far I think we've done everything that we're supposed to do on the notebook. I think we might have left one thing out, but if you don't tell, I won't tell. Let me just share this. This is Linda's words, and so she asked me if I would read these for you. This is one of the most difficult see you laters. Growing up in Lake Placid, you were known by everyone in one form or fashion. I was fortunate enough to have Big Mamas provide lunch for me most of my school years. Some may think that it's a big deal, yet if you ever knew about her cinnamon rolls or cinnamon twists or chocolate chip cookies, you would realize how great of a treat that really was. So can I have a witness who had cinnamon twists, cinnamon rolls, and chocolate chip cookies? So the rest of us are missing out. So sorry that you don't know that about her, but Miss Spurlock, Miss Carol, Big Mama always pointed out how life could be sweeter And some of the more challenging times is when she loved the hardest, prayed the will of God to help us move forward, learning life lessons with grace and humility. She loved fiercely and without condition. In the difficult times of my life, she taught me about forgiveness and tender mercies. Many talks of everyday life with her about jobs, kids, events, nothing that was ever boring or dull. She wanted to know every detail and would remember what seemed to bother you the most. She would follow up with you about it during the next conversation. She was always concerned with the way things went, and no matter how well, she wanted it better for you. I found myself reconnecting with Big Mama 20 plus years. John and I began dating, and we invited her to lunch where we would meet with my two children. As I introduced her to my children, or my kids, she hugged them both tightly and said these words that I'll never forget. My name is Carol Spurlock, but my grandkids call me Big Mama. So that's what you should call me. She did not have to accept them as her grandkids, yet she did, with open arms and even more open heart. From that day on, both of my children gained another grandmother who was a prayer warrior and a cheerleader in all they did. In some of their toughest times, she made life sweeter with her love. I'm forever grateful to witness these things. Big Mom was very loyal. She was a friend and faithful confidant. She had many special friendships, and two which I paid particular attention to, her relationship with her sons, Rusty and John. She loved her two sons like a mama does, yet she was friends with them. She would joke, she would poke fun at them, of course cook, and do for them. There's nothing she wouldn't do to help to make their day brighter or better. They both did their best to do the same by her. She was a great example of a friend. Like many, we'll feel her loss, yet you won't have to search far to find memories to remind you of a smile, think about how she would laugh out loud, or mispronounce a word or phrase. The taste of her banana pudding, thank you for teaching me about the art of forgiveness, mercy, and love, being in any life circumstances. We will carry on without you here, yet we know Big Mama's love knows no boundaries of space or time. See you later, Linda. P.S. I will take care of those nails when I meet you the next time. I want to say thank you for all of you that have shared. And for those of you that stay afterwards, we have one of the most prized recipes, Big Mama's banana pudding. You're going to get a chance to try that and see how they've done in that. And so we'll have some time together afterwards. One of the things I love about Big Mama is I watched her life as people. She loved God. That's obvious. But what's exciting to me is that I watched her receive God's love for her, which then we benefited from that. A lot of people know about the Bible. A lot of people know about church. A lot of people go to church. But that wasn't who she was. She was a person that was transformed by the Jesus that she loved. She could talk to you about him. That was fun to hear and watch. But it was more special for me to watch her serve. And so I shared this at the graveside. And so we just had Vacation Bible School. And I was talking with Chris and Dana. I said, hey, would you mind just giving me the names of the individuals that serve for Vacation Bible School? Susan and I would just like to write them a thank you note and send it out. Big Mama's name was on that list. As I sat in my office working my way down the list, Carol Spurlock. Carol Spurlock came in a couple days before, a week before, 83 at that point, right? Because she just turned 84. It was probably a little bit risky for her to be around children running around. And so instead of being around children that were running around, she came in to serve before it even got started. Not very many people who are 83 come in and serve. But that's who she was. And what I want to celebrate is not that characteristic of a servant quality, but I think we need to be aware of that, where it came from. It wasn't just a natural gift and ability. I really believe that her being loved by Jesus said, you know what, I want to go do something for somebody else. I am going to love fiercely. I'm not going to give up on you. Or you get in a conversation, hey, how are you doing? What's going on? Tell me about, she would often ask me, tell me about Rachel. What is she doing? Tell me about Seth. What is he doing? And so I would, you know, stop and tell her information. But what I loved also about her is this, have the privilege of looking at one of her Bibles in John 16:33. These things I have spoken unto you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation, but take good cheer. I have overcome the world. Of all the people, and Eva's highlighted this, of anyone that could have complained or should have complained or given up on this, Jesus says he loves me, but look at all these things. Big Mama was not a whiner. Big Mama was a warrior. And so no matter what God sent her, and one of the things I think that is true about the diamond and the rough, Big Mama was formed. God formed her for us to watch. So don't miss that. Think about the character qualities. I would encourage you to make banana pudding if you can get the recipe. I don't know if they're going to pass that out very far. Do those things. But in the process of doing life, allow that Jesus that affected Big Mama to be inputted into your life and say, okay, Lord, what do you want to do in my life? What do you want to change out of my life? In front of you is the poster or plaque or whatever you want to call it in front of us. This was in Big Mama's house. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, it's on the back of your program. It says, love is patient, it's kind. It's not jealous or boastful, or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It's not irritable. It keeps no records of wrong. It does not rejoice in injustice, but rejoices with the truth, wins out. Love never gives up, never fails, is always hopeful, and endures through every circumstance. May that be true of what the gospel is in you, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, that you will be a person of patience, not because you're trying harder, not because you had a second cup of coffee, but because of what Jesus is doing in your life, that the word of God will pour out of who you are as you have a chance to interact with it. One last passage of scripture, and for a pastor, it's so cool to go through and look at a Bible, and in here are handwritten notes. And so the passage that I'm reading to you are handwritten notes that she has in her Bible. And so the last one that I want to read to you is Psalm chapter 8. And you read these words, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth, who has set thy glory above the heavens. Out of the mouths of babes and sucklings, thou hast ordained strength because of thine enemies. Thou art mightiest still among the enemies and the avenger. When I consider the heavens, what a cool opportunity for us today. Go back and do all the memories, but don't miss what God did in her life, how the gospel interacted and who she was. And now may you make a decision and say, you know what, Jesus, because I have a Bible and because I have an opportunity to read it, I would encourage you to open it. But don't just open it and don't just read it. Allow it to be truth for you. And one day, somebody will be able to stand up and say, you know, we're celebrating Big Mama, but we're really celebrating the cross that was in Big Mama and her love for Jesus. May that be true of your life as well.
Thank you, John and Spurlock family, for giving me this opportunity to share with you today. Some of you know who I am and some of you don't. I was the founding pastor of Bible Fellowship Church. Grew up in Sebring for 77 years of my life. And as a community resident for that long, we get to know people, some very closely and some at a distance. As I looked at Carol's Bible, I also saw a list of scriptures under the title family. And family means so much to me, and I'm so glad you are here as a family today. And all of you who love her and know her. God has brought us together in her life, and we've been affected by that, and he's brought us together in her death. And we want to use this opportunity to consider not only life, but what happens after we die. And I'll share a little bit about that with you, not extensively, but I want to share some things with you that I think that are important. Growing up in Sebring in Highlands County, I didn't know Carol personally well, perhaps at a distance, probably knew her husband Carl better at a distance as well. But as I think about Carol, I would call her old school. By that I mean God, country, family, and hard work. She was straightforward when she talked. Ebba referred to that. Straightforward when she talked. But she wasn't mean. She didn't mean to be mean. She just meant to be purposeful in what she had to say. There was no pretense with her. And when I talked with her, I always felt like I'd always known her. There wasn't any distance barrier, time or any other way. And I want to get to the heart of the matter when I say this. And you know this very well, all that you know her. Carol was not a fake. She was not a fake. She was genuine. She was not a hypocrite. The Lord Jesus used the word hypocrite about 16 times in the Gospel, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. A hypocrite is one who wears a mask as if to cover who they really are and not wanting you to know. Carol was not that. She was not one who would wear a mask like actors portraying someone else that they're not. And I found as I went through her Bible, I found a number of verses underlined in Matthew 16, and I found also other verses that were circled. By the way, it's a good thing to mark up your Bible. It's not a sin. It's a good thing to read your Bible. If you have a Bible and you're reading it and some passage sticks out to you, get a highlighter and highlight it. Somebody, your grandchildren or somebody's going to read that someday. Somebody's going to have your Bible, and they're going to be touched by what touched you. And most likely the person that you have their Bible was in some time praying for you. So you are free, as a pastor would say, to mark up your Bible. It probably is an honor to God Almighty when you do. I found in a verse in her Bible that was circled, Matthew 6:16. We call this the Sermon on the Mount. I've been to Galilee several times. And you sit up above the hill of the Lake of Galilee. It's not a sea. It's not a saltwater. It's a freshwater lake. It's huge. It gives Israel most of its water during the year. And Jesus was sitting up there with thousands and thousands of people who had come to hear him. Most of them were Jews. Probably some were Gentiles that lived in the area. But they wanted to hear who this Jesus was and hear what he had to say. And he was very pinpointed with what he had to say to the Jews that were listening. And he was talking about something that was very important in the Jewish culture, and that was fasting. They did it on a regular basis. But those who wore masks, that is, those who were hypocrites, those whose hearts were not right with God, wanted to pretend like they were right with God. And they did certain things. I can remember years ago growing up, if you didn't smoke, drink, go to movies, dance, and go with the women that did, you're a good Christian. But that's not what the Bible teaches. That's not what the Bible teaches. But that was crammed down us. And I thought, well, if I don't do those things, I'm a good Christian, and I'll be sure to go to heaven. That's not what the scriptures teach. Now, those things can hurt you and do you bad, do things for your soul and your body that you want. But that's not what makes you a good Christian. It's not what's out on the outside. It's what it's on the inside. And Jesus is making a very important point here. And we're talking about Jesus, but we're also talking about Carol. She was not a hypocrite. Jesus says, and he's looking to this crowd, he says, when you fast, this was a cultural thing, a thing that they did regularly. When you fast, do not look somber as hypocrites do. Oh, so I'm fasting, I really want to look like it so that you'll know that I'm really a good Jewish follower. Do not do like the hypocrites do, for they disfigure their faces to show men that they are fasting. So they look, oh, man, I'm having a bad day. I've been fasting all day long. I haven't had anything to eat. No. Jesus says, I tell you the truth that they have their full reward. They get their pat on the back. Oh, you had a bad fast day, and I know you're hungry, and oh, you did so well today. That's their reward. But Jesus looks at the crowd and says, but when you fast, put oil on your head. In other words, wash your face, wash your hair, comb your hair, look good, look like you're having a good day. You're not faking it. Put on oil on your head, wash your face, so that it will not be obvious to men that you are fasting. They don't know what, they don't need to know you're fasting. If you think you want people to know, then you're faking it. But only to your Father who is unseen. Be obvious to him. Nobody's looking, nobody sees him, but your Father sees you. And your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. Now, obviously, as we follow the Lord Jesus Christ, there ought to be examples in our lives that show that we belong to him. And that was true of Carol. But she wasn't out faking it. The Bible says in the last days there will be people who have a form of godliness. They look like it, but they deny the power thereof. Their hearts are not right with God. And that's crucial. That's crucial. My guess is that when Carol entered heaven and met Jesus and bowed before her Savior for the first time, her rewards began to flow and will be complete at the judgment seat of Christ. What is the judgment seat of Christ anyway? Are you going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ? I am. And all believers in the Lord Jesus will stand before the judgment seat of Christ. All non-believers are going to stand at a total another judgment called the Great White Throne. I'm not going to get into all that today, but I want to just talk to the Christians today. Those of you who truly have put your faith in the Lord Jesus, we're going to stand before the Lord Jesus, and we're going to give an account of how we've lived our Christian life. All the sins that we've ever committed before God and we've trusted to Jesus as our personal Savior are under the blood of Christ. Because he died on the cross for us, he shed his blood that covers our sins. Because the wages of sin is death, somebody has to pay for those sins. Either you do or a substitute does. And God Almighty sent his Son to be our substitute, to die in our place, so that we come to Jesus as our personal Savior and we put our trust in him. Our sins are forgiven. Okay? So now I'm on my way to heaven, not on my way to hell. All that's in the past. All the sins that would commit me to hell are over because I'm under the blood of Christ. But how do I live my life now? How did Carol live her life now? I heard of her love for family. I heard of her love for the Lord. I heard of her witness and her work and her service. She will stand before the Lord at the judgment seat of Christ, and she will be rewarded for the things she did that honored our God and our Savior. And so all of you who are believers will too. Now, some of you have made a profession of faith in the Lord Jesus, but you haven't been living for him. You may have made that decision when you were a child, a teenager, a 7-year-old, a 30-year-old, I don't know. But you haven't been living for the Lord Jesus as Carol had been living for him. And so you need to make a decision. I have a hunch. If she could call you out, if Big Mama could call you out today, she would say, look, you need to get with the program. You need to humble yourself before God Almighty. You need to repent of your life, where you've been living. You say you're a Christian. You say you've trusted Christ. Can we see it? Can we tell it? So Big Mama is saying to you, I'm saying to you, it's time to humble yourself and get yourself right with God. Because there's coming a day when you as a believer in Christ, who are not living for him now but should be living, are going to stand before him. And there are going to be rewards for living for Christ and loss of rewards. Our salvation has been paid for. That's under the blood of Christ. We've trusted him. But what is your life like now? That's important. And we sit here today because Carol's life and her death have brought us together, and we're honoring God Almighty, and we're saying, look what Carol has portrayed before us. Not a hypocrite. Not a hypocrite. But a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, and she lived it. And we got to see it. We got to taste it. We got to feel it. We got to eat it in a banana pudding. We got to feel her hugs. We got to hear her exhortation. We were disciplined by her. We were part of her life because she loved him and she loved us. So I would say, how are you doing? Have you put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior? How is your fellowship with other believers? Do you have any fellowship with other believers, or are you just doing your thing? Are you just out there? When COVID hit us, we had to shut down church. We had to go to Zoom. We had to go to all this high-tech stuff. And we weren't able to fellowship like we would have liked to have. And some of us just yearned to get back in fellowship and be with each other, hug one another, talk to one another, encourage one another, sing with one another, worship with one another. And then some people have made excuses, well, I haven't been back because COVID got me out of the habit. That's over for now. That's over for now. Are you reading your Bible regularly, or does it just sit there? Or do you have one? Do you have one that you can read easily because it's a translation that you like? There are dozens of translations out there. We have no excuses for not reading our Bible. No excuses. I'm talking to Christians who've made a profession of faith. I'm not talking to non-believers. I'm talking to family believers. There's no excuse. I cannot live a day without reading my Bible. I cannot. I must have God speak to me somehow, some way, because I don't know what the day holds. I don't know who I'm going to talk to. I don't know who I'm going to meet. I don't know if I'm going to have an accident or have a disease. I need God in my life all the time. And as Kay said in one of her thoughts, we're not absent. The Holy Spirit is with us. He hasn't left us. When you come to faith in Christ, the Holy Spirit comes to live within you and begins to make sense out of all of this. We're not talking rubbish and science fiction here. We live in a day when the Lord Jesus returned probably is very soon. And you need to be in fellowship with him. Are you saying to me this morning, well, I can't go back to church? If I went back to church, I'd be a real hypocrite. Because I don't really have it in my heart. Well, that's the issue. That's the issue. Where's your heart before God this morning or this afternoon? Where's your heart? You need to get your heart right with God. And Carol would call us out, or Big Mama would say, get on your knees and humble yourself. God, forgive me. I have not been in fellowship with you. I have not been in fellowship with believers. I've been out here doing my thing like the world. But I need you. I need what Big Mama had in her life. I need you. So there's a humbling process when we admit the truth. The Bible says if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins. He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. He's ready for us to come and talk to him. He's ready. He's ready. He's waiting. Our Lord doesn't push anything down your throat. He does not work that way. He came down here to love us and show how to live, and he died on the cross so that we could spend eternity with him. That's the way it is. Carol knew that, and she is in heaven now, not because we want her to be. She's in heaven because she had faith in God Almighty, who raised Jesus from the dead and put her up in heaven with him, and he's coming back, and that body that you put out in the grave today, or whatever, I don't know if she cremated or what it was, that body that you put out in that grave today will be raised again at the moment Jesus comes. And I believe he's coming soon. The dead in Christ shall rise first, and those of us who are alive and remain will be caught up with them to be with them in the clouds forever. So encourage each other with these words. So I'm here to challenge you to humble yourself before God. I'm here to challenge you to say, Lord, I've been out there in the world. Bring me back to you. I'm willing to do that today. God may be speaking to your heart today through Carol Singer Spurlock's life and death. If it's true, don't run away from God. Oh, don't run. Run to him. Run to him. He's waiting like the father waits for the prodigal son. He is ready for you to come to him. And he'll receive you in a heartbeat. He's ready for you. Now, for those of you who have never, ever said, Lord, oh, I need you. I am a sinner. I know that for a fact. I'm not going to be a hypocrite before you, God. I need you. Today you can say, Dear Heavenly Father, I trust in you And I'm trusting Jesus today to be my personal Savior. You cannot save yourself. And we've been raised for the last 60 years in this mentality that you're the most important person on earth. Everything's about me. Everything's about me. Everything's about me. Everything's about me. I can do what I want. You can't stand before God one day and say, everything's about me. You need to say before God one day, everything is about Jesus, the Son of God, our Creator, Lord Jesus, who came. Today you can say, God, you're speaking to me. I want to put my trust in the Lord Jesus today to be my personal Savior. Now what I'm going to do is I'm just going to lead you in a prayer. This is between you and God, not between you and me. This is between you and God. This is between you and God. You talk to him. I'll just help you voice it. So let's bow our heads and pray together. For those of you who've sometime in your life made a profession of faith in the Lord Jesus but have not been living for him, you've just been living for pure old self or whatever is going on in your life, you need him now. And I would just encourage you to say with me, dear God in heaven, please forgive me. You can just pray this in your heart. Dear God in heaven, please forgive me. I need to get right with you, and I'm not. And I just want you to renew my heart for you. Cause me to love you like Big Mama loved you. Cause me to live for you as the example that I've seen in her life and other people. Draw me back to you, Lord, and give me a heart for you. Cleanse me and wash me, I pray. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And for those of you who have never made a profession of faith in Jesus, you can do that this afternoon. You can say, dear Heavenly Father, please forgive me of all my sins. I'm putting my trust in the Lord Jesus for the first time. This is real to me now, God. For the first time, for sure, I'm putting my faith in you. I'm asking you to forgive me, and I'm putting my trust in Jesus who died on the cross for me. Thank you, thank you, thank you. In Jesus' precious name, amen. May the Lord bless you, and thank you for this time with you today.
Go to heaven.
assume that Big Mama wanted us to sing this song. So in knowing, all of you were absolutely correct. You had to ask Big Mama's permission. And it was always, yes, ma'am. Always. Let's stand together. The words are on the screen. What a great song. All to Jesus I surrender.
Pause this afternoon and we close our time together saying thank you. Thank you that today hurts. Thank you that today is uncomfortable because you gave us an incredible gift. Some call her Carol. Some call her Big Mama. You call her daughter. And so as we go forward, may I surrender all be part of who we are. In our brokenness, in our joy, we would come running to you the way we saw Big Mama come run to you. So thank you for this day. As we go and celebrate, just having some food and telling stories, may this legacy continue on for your glory, Jesus. It's in your name we pray.
One day.
We're going to ask the family to walk across this way. Thank you for joining us. We do have some food on that side, so if you'd like to come have an afternoon snack with us, please come and join us.
At a time, sweet Jesus. I'm all